In June 1978 at Kingsway Hall, there was a standard analogue recording session of Ashkenazy playing some Mozart piano concertos. In the background, however, there was also an experimental trial of the prototype recording digital chain. The results of this trial were deemed a great success. The recording engineers listened to the direct digital playback on the 800 compared with the analogue equivalent, and they felt the results to be superior compared with the analogue tapes. So this successful trial led to the final part of the build, which was to sort out how they could arrange a system to edit on location. The team's solution is a really ingenious combination of old tried and tested techniques that the engineers would have been able to do in their sleep, combined with some much newer practices. It kept some traditional, well-honed reel-to-reel techniques, but definitely ditched the razor blades and glue stage. As digital encoding avoided the deterioration associated with copying analog tape, it was time to incorporate linear editing techniques. Anyone with experience of making mixtapes in the 80s and 90s on one of these should recognize the basic editing principle of having two tape decks linked together, the first to play the original track, while the second records copies of each track in sequence. Decca's digital team linked two 800 series videotape recorders together in a similar way, but with much more sophisticated options. To enable those fast analog reel-to-reel techniques, the digital team added in a medium quality analog signal along with the digital signal with each recorded take. Having in parallel on the tape an easily accessed analog version enabled the engineers to quickly identify and mark the optimal edit points. And they did this by manually turning the reels a bit like how a DJ would cue up a record. But instead of the literal cut and paste, putting each digital edit together could be done in a much smoother, more sophisticated way. The old cut and paste, abrupt butt end edits could be upgraded to fast crossfades. The editing design provided sufficient memory to enable rehearsal of edits. If they were unsatisfactory, it also offered some fine-tuning options, including slight adjustments in the timing of the editing points, but also the volume of the second part of the edit could be altered up or down to get a smoother join. Once a good quality version of the edit was available, this could then be stored. The team also worked out another positive way to use the second recorder that was required to enable location editing. During the recording of each take, the second machine was joined up in parallel to record a second copy as extra insurance in case any catastrophic failure occurred with the first tape. In December 1978, things got real. Tony Griffiths and Roy Hankinson accompanied the Decca engineers to the Sofiensaal for a recording session of Doc Nanny conducting the VPO, playing some Mendelssohn pieces, including the Italian Symphony. This session provided a really useful road test a few days before the crunch time of the New Year's Day live recording session. The New Year's Day recording came out on the vinyl format much earlier than the Mendelssohn. The New Year's Day concert was probably chosen just because it was more of an event, a sort of big ticket start to this new series of recordings. The live New Year's Day concert obviously was a very different proposition than the earlier Sofiensaal recording session. They decided to record all of the rehearsals in case there were any prominent mistakes so that they could use that earlier recording as a second tape if required. In addition to the vinyl copy I've got here of the double album, I also got the CD version in the box set, the Decca Sound. And when I get my energy back after I've had a nice lie down, I will start working on talking about comparing the different versions of various bits of my digital Decca collection that I've picked up over the years. And I'll feed back to you in that video my preferences on CD format as well as vinyl. When looking into the digital story, I've often noticed parallels with the Decca stereo story. But there are important differences, and one glaring difference is the amount of time that was allowed to Wallace and other engineers working on stereo, in that it was nearly 4 years that they had to get that sound just right before stereo records and players became available. In contrast with digital, they didn't even have 4 months really before the vinyl equivalents came out. I still think it's amazing to think that a 1970s reel-to-reel videotape was still involved in the recording chain up until about 1997, when the Decca team was unceremoniously closed by Polygram. So I hope this historical overview has been of interest to you. I'll try my best to get the accompanying video out pretty soon. And until then, take care. Bye.